Hello, everyone, and welcome to Attitude Magazine's ADHD Experts broadcast. We hope everyone is staying safe and staying well. We are pleased to have Roberto Olivardia here to talk about the links between ADHD and obsessive compulsive disorder and how to diagnose and treat both when they occur together. Before we get started, let me note a couple of housekeeping items. Those of you tuned into the live webinar may download the slides now by clicking on the event resources section of your webinar screen. And if you're interested in the certificate of attendance option, look for instructions in the email you'll receive around an hour after the live broadcast. For those of you listening in replay or podcast mode, you can visit attitudemag.com and search podcast 343 to access the slides, the webinar replay, and the certificate of attendance option. And finally, if you support the work we're doing here at Attitude to strengthen the ADHD community, we encourage you to visit attitudemag.com/subscribe and sign up for Attitude Magazine for your family or to share with a teacher or a loved one who could benefit from greater understanding of ADHD. Now for today's topic. ADHD and the co-occurring condition, obsessive-compulsive disorder. ADHD and OCD are both characterized by executive functioning deficits in the areas of organization, motivation, decision-making, and attention. It is common that when people have both disorders, one of them goes undiagnosed. Dr. Olivardia will tap into the latest research literature on this understudied comorbidity. For those with a dual diagnosis, failure to identify and treat either disorder can significantly affect treatment progress for the other. The good news is that when a person is properly diagnosed, treatments are available that will help you manage symptoms of both disorders. Dr. Olivardia is a clinical psychologist and clinical instructor of psychology at Harvard Medical School. He maintains a private psychotherapy practice in Lexington, Massachusetts, where he specializes in the treatment of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, of course, executive functioning issues, and issues that face students with learning differences. You can ask questions during Roberto's presentation, and we will get to as many of them as we can after he finishes. So with all that being said, I'll turn it over to Roberto. Thanks so much for being here today.
Oh, thank you for having me, Wayne, and thanks for everyone out there who's joining us on this Thursday afternoon. So I'm here to talk about ADHD and OCD, or obsessive compulsive disorder, and let me first define what we mean in terms of the symptoms of OCD. So OCD is characterized by having either obsessions and or compulsions. So people can just have one or have both. And by an obsession, we're talking about recurrent, persistent thoughts, impulses. It could be an image that somebody has that they experience as intrusive and inappropriate, and that causes a lot of anxiety and distress for them, and that these thoughts, these impulses, these images are not simply excessive worries of real life problems. So it's not that somebody, for example, worried about, you know, getting COVID, for example, or worried about, you know, how their child is doing in college. Those are sort of real life kind of extensions. These are sort of thoughts and images that feel very intrusive, that often even for the individual, you know, they might even feel that the thoughts are irrational in some ways. And it feels very persistent and is often something that kind of like hijacks their mind, is sort of how they would describe it. Now, a compulsion are repetitive behaviors, and that include things like hand washing. It could be ordering things. It could be checking things. Or it could be mental acts such as praying or counting, repeating words silently, having certain images in your head that a person feels driven to perform in response to the obsession, oftentimes, and according to rules that must be applied rigidly. And the goal really is to neutralize the anxiety brought on by an obsessive behavior. So it's about trying to prevent something from happening or reducing the distress of whatever dreaded situation or event. Now, sometimes people just have compulsions in the absence of obsessions where they'll say, I just feel driven to do this and I don't know why and I don't have a specific thought. I don't have a fear of anything happening. And that can also qualify for OCD. But more times than not, you'll often find that the compulsion is really meant to sort of quiet, reduce, or prevent an obsessive thought. And by that, just to give you some examples of obsessive thoughts could be things like, if I have a bad thought, then my mother's going to get breast cancer. So that individual might really get very anxious anytime they have what they regard as a bad thought. It could be certainly people are aware of like contamination fears. If I, you know, touch the doorknob, then I'm going to die. And again, these are not just if I touch the doorknob, I could get germs, but these individuals then will wash their hands many times to try to neutralize that thought. Somebody who, let's say, has a bad thought might feel if they say the Our Father prayer 10 times, then their anxiety reduces and they feel that they sort of neutralize the likelihood of that thing happening. If I don't order these things in a certain way, then it'll make me feel, you know, really uncomfortable or I fear that something bad will happen. Now, studies looking at prevalence actually find that the comorbidity of ADHD and OCD is much more common than people would think it to be. And in fact, a lot of these studies have looked at with samples of people with OCD, as opposed to we don't have much research looking at samples of individuals with ADHD and seeing how many of them have OCD. But there are a number of studies that have looked at samples of people with OCD and seeing how many of them have ADHD. And as you can see, it can range from 10 to 44%. I put a star near the 30% because many of the studies tend to find about a 30% comorbidity of people with OCD that have ADHD. And family history studies show an association of OCD and ADHD, meaning that someone with ADHD is more likely to have someone in their family with OCD than someone who doesn't have ADHD, and vice versa. Someone who has OCD is more likely to have a family member that likely has ADHD than what you would see in the general population. Now, where does ADHD present itself with OCD? Typically, and so with OCD, there are many different manifestations. I mean, hand washing is sort of the popular one that is often portrayed in a lot of Hollywood movies. There's actually a lot of different versions of OCD, and also what we refer to as the obsessive compulsive spectrum. So the OCD spectrum is a collection of disorders and conditions that really have this genetic underlying trait of obsessionality and compulsivity. And that represents OCD, hoarding disorder, tics, Tourette's disorder, body-focused repetitive behaviors, which are things like skin picking, nail biting, trichotillomania, which is compulsive hair pulling. These are all within the spectrum. Body dysmorphic disorder, where people have a preoccupation about a part or parts of their body image that they feel have a lot of obsessive thoughts about, and then will have a lot of compulsive or avoidant behaviors around. And we often will see this comorbidity of ADHD and what we call pure O OCD, which is the pure obsessionality. So individuals who have OCD that don't have compulsive behaviors, they're just riddled by a lot of obsessive thoughts and a lot of obsessional thinking. And with pure OCD, which actually in the family of OCD disorders, often is doesn't get identified as the OCD that's coupled with compulsions, because a lot of times it sort of gets diagnosed as having anxiety or generalized anxiety, but meanwhile, the thoughts are very obsessive. We'll often see ADHD in combination with that form of OCD. Hoarding, which has been regarded for years as being in the obsessive compulsive spectrum, more emerging research is showing that one of the most common features amongst people who have hoarding disorder are very poor executive function. And I would say clinically, I would say most of the people that I work with hoarding issues have ADHD. Tics and Tourette's disorder, which are both characterized by sort of impulsive, either vocal utterances, motor tics that have this sort of degree of impulsivity that studies show that oftentimes you'll see ADHD in combination with that. So something about the sort of impulsivity that gives rise to certainly the ADHD as well as these tic or Tourette symptoms. And as I mentioned before, body-focused repetitive behaviors like skin picking and trichotillomania, which have long been regarded as sort of just part of OCD. Now with hoarding, just to give you an example of some of the differences that we might see, is with someone who's kind of more on the ADHD spectrum of hoarding versus the more classic kind of OCD spectrum, is looking at how they acquire their material. A lot of times with ADHD, people are impulsive spenders. They acquire a lot of stuff. They get bored of it very quickly, and they just keep buying more stuff. And so that's how they end up acquiring a lot of those things. For other hoarders that might sort of fall more on the classic OCD spectrum, or individuals that just save a lot of things and just don't throw out, they're actually not impulsive. They're often very, very frugal individuals that don't throw out anything. And with ADHD, a lot of the people I work with ADHD who have hoarding issues, it's very what we call ego dystonic. They're very bothered by it. They if they could pay somebody to declutter and throw things out, they would. Whereas if anyone has ever seen the show Hoarders, for many people who are more on that kind of obsessive compulsive end, would never do it. And in fact, are a little bit ego syntonic, which means they're not as bothered by the hoarding and the clutter as one would expect them to be. The motivation for holding on to things is also a little bit different. For people with ADHD, sometimes I'll have patients that say, I don't want to throw anything out, and I'll inquire more about that. And they'll say, my main motivation is, what if I need it later? And by not having it, then I have to go through all of these basically executive steps to either make up for it in some ways. So the motivation for holding on to things is really so that I can save some executive bandwidth in the future. So I don't want to throw this thing out, not because I'm really attached to it, but because if I end up needing it in the future, and then it requires me to have to go to so-and-so office and go to the photocopying machine and fax it, and I don't want to do that, so I'll just save it. Whereas for individuals more on the obsessive compulsive spectrum, it really is around this idea of not ridding oneself of things. Then there's a level of sentimentality that's attached to everything, almost like too much so in such an even way for people with obsessive compulsive hoarding. So they have as much sentimentality to a used napkin as they can to a birthday card they got from their wife and their first birthday together. The effect of clutter also has a big difference. For people with ADHD, they're often could be distracted by it, and it often makes their ADHD symptoms worse. People with hoarding, they're almost, again, they're not subjectively as distracted by it as much as one would think it to be. The role that perfectionism plays for people with ADHD, sometimes hoarding it also be this way of, I'm going to buy this thing to try to perfect a system. Like I worked with someone years ago that had 40 different appointment books and planners because she was looking for the perfect one. And when she realized it didn't work, she wasn't going to return it. She had already used it. And she felt the sense of shame, actually, in throwing it out because it was an admission of failure that none of those appointment books worked in that way. So you'll often see with people with ADD this sort of way of trying to optimize things. One of the biggest differential factors is the sense of morality that people with more the OCD kind of hoarding attach a sense of being immoral by throwing things out, because then they're wasteful individuals in that way. So it becomes a very characterological attack. Whereas with people with just ADHD, I don't really hear that as much, this sort of sense of morality that's attached to throwing things out, or a personification of objects, which you'll hear in people with very severe obsessive compulsive hoarding, where they almost treat objects as if they have feelings, as if they're people in that way. Now, similar with body-focused repetitive behaviors, things like skin picking and nail biting, Sometimes there are differential factors there as to whether is it more ADD related, is this more OCD related, and of course people can have both in that. But if we're just looking at it from a binary, with ADHD, those body-focused repetitive behaviors' main function is in providing stimulation and arousal. So the nail biting, the skin picking is all about getting little dopamine hits, basically, which all of those behaviors can produce. It can be sometimes with ADHD individuals, what starts the behavior is that they're distracted by an uneven nail that they might be sort of feeling, or they're distracted, by a pimple that could be on their face or something like that. And they're sort of picking at it to just rid themselves of the distraction of it. Certainly poor impulse control that you'll see. It can be very hyper-focusing. I mean, body-focused behaviors are very sensory in nature, which definitely, you know, people with ADHD are very drawn and find very, very appealing. It can be very grounding, those behaviors, for people with ADHD, and they find that it almost anchors them and kind of makes them more present, almost like a fidget toy would, except that their body, in some ways, is the fidget. It can be stress relief. It could be an escape from executive demands, where someone almost kind of gets into a trance because they're feeling very overwhelmed by a lot of executive stress. And people with ADD will often say that they feel this sort of sense of a goal orientation. So if it's a hair that seems, very straggly, and they pull it, like they feel like they've accomplished something. And that could be incredibly reinforcing for people with ADHD who sometimes don't always feel that way about regular executive demands in their life. Now, when we think of OCD, OCD is also an executive functioning disorder. Now, the model that is used in the OCD research is one of what they call executive overload, meaning that because the person is so heady in terms of their obsessions and all the things that they're thinking about, it creates a spillover where then it makes it hard for them to attend to anything that's happening outside of them. There are selective attention deficits. So for example, the person with ADHD might be, their attention is going to always be oriented towards what is stimulating, the shiny nickel. The person with sort of more classic OCD, their attention is going to be, what is the biggest threat in the room? And that's what I'm paying attention to. So it's almost a hyper-focus on what is threatening. And to someone with OCD, it could be one's thoughts could be the thing that's threatening, and that's what gets paid attention to. If it's the stain on the carpet that feels very, very distressing to that person, that's the thing they're paying attention to. But people with OCD have difficulty planning. They have difficulty filtering out irrelevant data, but often due to a need for completeness. So if you take two college students, one with just ADHD, one with just OCD, writing notes in a college lecture, the person with ADHD might have a hard time because their working memory is not being able to keep up with what the professor is saying. They might have a hard time knowing what's important, what's not. I'm not really sure. The person with OCD wants to write everything down because of that sense of perfectionism. But there's an element that overlaps, which is I can't prioritize what's the most important thing. So it's best to just write everything down. So that's just as much of an executive function issue for the person with OCD as it is for the person with ADD. People with OCD also have impaired inhibition. I mean, compulsions are, we call them compulsions because there's a lot of thought that often goes into them before acting in most of the cases for people who have obsessions. But in a way, there's an impulsive element to compulsivity as well, which is even with patients who say, every part of me is like, I don't need to be checking the stove again, or I don't need to be washing my hands again, but I just do it because I'm like, well, if I feel better after doing it, I might as well just do it. And there's an impaired inhibition there. The difficulty with filtering out obsessive thoughts. People with OCD on neuropsych testing often have difficulty with set shifting, sort of, being able to sort of be flexible in terms of how they see things, mentally, have cognitive deficits on visual memory tasks, also have working memory difficulties, decision-making. Now, unlike someone, a classic ADHD individual, which might be more impulsive, the person with OCD is thinking way too much before making a decision, to the point where they're paralyzed by making decisions. People with OCD often have an inflated sense of responsibility. So there's this high often degree of morality integrated with OCD. So people feel that every decision they make almost carries this paramount level of a sort of moral code attached to it, which makes everything seem so much more profound in some ways than it really needs to be. There's a tremendous amount of doubt in people with OCD, that doubt around like, did I shut the stove? I know I shut the stove. I even said to myself, I shut the stove, but did that happen today? Did that happen yesterday? And then the more you sort of doubt, the more you can convince yourself that maybe it did happen yesterday. Maybe I'm just imagining it. And so some of that is definitely executive functioning issues. Now, if you look at OCD and ADHD, they almost seem to have opposite, we almost can be thinking that we're looking at opposites of a spectrum, spontaneous versus planful, impulsive, compulsive, unaware of social cues, being way too sensitive of social cues, the thrill seeker versus the overly cautious person, the pleasure seeker, the anxiety avoider. Tom Hartman's book, he talked about the hunters and the farmers. And so in some ways, it might seem like they're opposites, but there is this overlap that very much characterizes them both, which makes sense as to why we would see them occur together. However, I have found that many times one of these conditions is often underdiagnosed. So ADHD is often missed in people with OCD all the time. I mean, first of all, ADHD is rarely assessed in clinical settings, especially in adults. So when adults are hospitalized for, let's say, a psychotic episode or a manic episode, depressive episodes, substance abuse, usually in intakes, you look for a history of depression and other mood disorders, anxiety disorders, OCD, eating disorders. Very rarely do those individuals ever get assessed or even asked whether they have a diagnosis of ADHD, which we need to do a lot more work on. Sometimes symptoms might intertwine with each other, that might look like one thing, when it's another. So for example, in patients with OCD, and I could relate to this because when I was in college, having ADHD, when I was in college, before sitting to write a paper, I would basically find anything I can, to distract myself or procrastinate on the paper. But part of it would include meticulously cleaning my room. So all my friends knew Roberto was about to write a paper because I was Windexing the mirrors. I was cleaning every piece of dust. And, I was not the most organized, college student when I was not writing a paper. So, and they would say, oh, you have, you're so OCD, which I don't like that phrase, but that's what would say. And I'm like, no, it's not about being clean, or perfect or organized. A lot of it was just a way of procrastinating. And part of it also was, I do need my space to be clear to think straight, because, as far as how my ADHD worked, I find clutter very visually distracting. So sometimes even in behaviors, we want to inquire a little bit more about the motivation behind it. And we might find ADHD might be more the culprit than the OCD. As we all know, in the ADHD community, there's still a lot of myths about ADHD, that it's just about focus, that it just impacts schooling. Everyone with ADHD is hyperactive. So if you're an OCD individual who does well in school because you have a high degree of perfectionism, maybe you're not hyperactive, sometimes ADHD isn't even looked at on the radar. ADHD behaviors sometimes are labeled as being resistant. Sometimes certain compulsions might be more related to the ADHD than they are the OCD, because people with ADHD often have to create their own systems sometimes of making things work and doing things a certain way, having their environments be structured in a very, very specific way that can look obsessive compulsive, but I call it almost more of one that has to be very specific in that way. Sensory defensiveness sometimes can be seen as perfectionism, the idea of like, oh, this is too loud, this is too bright, this is too spicy, when in fact that could be more related to ADHD sensory processing. I remember in third grade actually, where we had to write a little essay about a fictional character we identified with. And I mean, this is so diagnostic back then. And I said I picked Goldilocks from Goldilocks and the Three Bears, which my friends are like, why are you picking Goldilocks? And of course, I didn't know then what I know now, but I said, well, you know, for her, that bed was too hard and that bed was too soft, but this one was just right. That porridge was too hot, that porridge was too cold, and that was just right. And I identified with that because that was how I felt. Like I needed things to be just right in order to just ground myself and to focus and to get things done. And, you know, that was, you know, the writing was on the wall there. The distractibility can be seen as a positive. For people with OCD, they look to get out of their heads. They don't want these thoughts. So any kind of distractibility is almost welcomed and seen as a positive. Being hyper-focused, what we see in ADHD, can be mistaken as being over-focused, which is very different. So being over-focused is the person with OCD who's reading a sentence and they're literally reading the same sentence 20 times, not because they didn't understand it and not because they didn't comprehend it, but because they feel like they have to do that to perfectly do it, or they just can't not do that. That's different than a hyperfocus, where someone with ADHD will be reading fluidly, perhaps, and maybe read 100 pages in, you know, 3 hours straight and not be attending to anything else. The inattention in ADHD is sometimes looked at as being part of the OCD, or that the ADHD, the more hyperactivity, can be looked at as being anxiety. Now, having said that, OCD can often be missed in people with ADHD, where the overfocusing is mistaken as hyperfocus. There are a lot of myths about OCD. Everyone thinks OCD is just about contamination, or that all people with OCD are neat. Many manifestations of OCD. I remember someone saying, you know, he can't have OCD, he's too messy. That's a very simplistic way of looking at OCD. Just like the distractibility can be reinforcing for someone with OCD, the focus of OCD can sometimes be reinforcing for people with ADHD. And I'm not saying that they like it, it's just that it's more reinforcing. People with OCD often can feel a lot of shame because they often can feel crazy, and knowing that some of these symptoms are very irrational. A lot of the unfinished projects that happen to people with OCD get labeled sometimes as the ADHD cognitive fatigue, when in fact, for people with OCD, it could be these barriers or perfectionism. Like if you have to reread a paragraph 20 times, I had a patient years ago that he could not get through reading in school unless he read everything 25 times. You're going to just burn out after, you know, a while doing that. Very different than the person with ADHD who might start a project because it's fun and stimulating, then they kind of get bored, you know, in the maintenance of it, and they sort of move away from it. Perfectionism can be labeled as being stubborn or just around having the executive function issues of ADHD. Now, when we look at the brains and the neurological research of people with ADHD and OCD, we see that there are not these sort of characterological differences as much as these sort of spectrum issues of hypoactivation, where in ADHD, sometimes you see less activation than we should. With those and or immaturity in terms of the structure, we know that the ADHD brain doesn't fully develop until one's late 20s, as opposed to a neurotypical brain, which could be early to mid 20s. For people with OCD, we could see hyperactivation in certain brain parts, such as the anterior cingulate cortex, which is responsible for emotion regulation, impulse control, decision-making. Person with ADHD, if you don't have enough activation, you're gonna have somebody who's more emotionally impulsive, more emotionally dysregulated, is too quick at making decisions. If it's hyperactivated, you have somebody who's almost emotionally constricted, who is way too compulsive, who's thinking too much without having any emotional sort of connectivity to those decisions. Because in order to make a decision, we need our thoughts and we need our emotions to do that. Orbital frontal cortex, where decision-making is involved in, dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, part of the frontal lobe where our executive functions, our working memory, our attention, the thalamus, which is responsible for sleep, arousal, sensory processing. We know that people with ADHD often struggle with tremendous issues with sleep and sleep disorders. And in terms of arousal, of not sometimes being aroused enough in certain situations that lack a certain level of stimulation, people with OCD might be hyper aroused, almost like too keyed up in how they respond to an environment. Another part of the brain called the basal ganglia, which is this sort of bunch of different nuclei and cells that are implicated in habit learning and executive function and emotion. Part of the basal ganglia is a part called the caudate nucleus, of which there's a lot of research, particularly in the OCD literature, that houses centers for executive function, working memory, motivation, and reward. Now, what studies have found, again, is that you either have this hyperactivation, or both, that there's a dysregulation that's occurring for both people with ADHD as well as people with ADHD. So it's not that totally different brain parts are being implicated here, which makes sense why we would often see it together. Now, genetically, the genes that are most implicated with ADHD are the dopaminergic genes, or genes related to dopamine, which is a neurotransmitter that's responsible for reward seeking and motivation. With OCD, the genes are more implicated in the serotonergic or serotonin related genes. And that's why the medication of choice for people with OCD is an SSRI, a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. For ADHD, it's a stimulant treatment, which is more dopaminergic in nature. ADHD and OCD are both heritable. They both run in families. So having either of those conditions creates a higher likelihood that you'll have a family member with either of those conditions. Now, what's interesting is that I remember years ago sort of looking in the literature about the genetics and everything, like why do we see those aggregate, you know, in addition to what we know about the brain? Because if genetically, we know there are dopaminergic genes, serotonergic genes. And interestingly, what they find is that part of the aggregation in families is due to what's called non-random mating, which is that people with ADHD tend to marry people with OCD, or I should say people on the ADHD spectrum or with ADHD traits tend to marry people who are on the OCD spectrum with OCD traits. Now, that doesn't always happen. You'll either see people with ADHD that tend to what we call associative mating, that tend to marry other people with ADHD. But research also shows that people with ADHD have a higher divorce rate. So whether those relationships work well or not, you know, we don't know specifically in that term, but I can say many of the people that I work with who have ADHD, their spouses tend to be more on the obsessive compulsive end. And it makes sense in some ways. I mean, and I think both parties can benefit from having a partner that might be, in the case of, you know, someone more on the obsessive compulsive spectrum, who's more organized, who's going to make sure the taxes get paid and the bills get paid and has a good order of how things are. And the person with OCD could benefit from the person with ADHD, who could be more perhaps spontaneous and out of the box in that way. Provided that, of course, that both parties are appreciative of what each brings to the table. And there's a lot of understanding as to, you know, what each of those conditions or traits sort of bring to it. Now, when people have both ADHD and OCD, it makes each condition more difficult. And so as opposed to thinking like 1 + 1 = 2, it really is the whole becomes greater than the sum of its parts. So what we would say is 1 + 1 = 5 when people have both ADHD and OCD. It makes it very difficult. Now, I have to say, though, that I would say almost all of my patients who I've ever worked with who have both OCD and ADHD are pretty self-aware of what symptoms are the ADHD and which ones are the OCD. Even though it can, you know, sometimes it can be seem hard to tease out in terms of what's driving the bus. So if I'm in a class and I'm inattentive, am I inattentive because I have an obsessive thought that if I think of the word AIDS, that someone in my family is going to get AIDS, and that then creates an inattentive? Or am I inattentive first because I'm bored and I'm distracted? And then because I'm bored by what the professor's saying, I'm going to something that's more stimulating, and again, not intentionally and not pleasurably, which is an obsessive thought, is incredibly stimulating. And so what's happening first or second? And I would say a lot of patients are pretty well aware of what's driving the bus. And it's not always the same thing. I mean, it's so situational and and contextual. And so part of the work is really understanding how they interact with each other. The age of onset for OCD tends to be earlier when someone also has ADHD. So typically age of onset for OCD we'll see in the adolescent years, certainly with traits that go back to childhood. But in terms of full-blown symptoms, if someone has ADHD, we often will see that younger. Now, there are no empirical treatment studies per se that look at the comorbidity when people have both. But we can, you know, there's one just in terms of that looked at a sample of people with OCD and ADHD and found that people with OCD needed more mood stabilizers more frequently. The rate of patients with OCD that responded to SSRIs were unaffected by ADHD diagnosis. So SSRIs were effective, you know, either way. With ADHD, now, as far as psychopharmacologically, that stimulant treatment may exacerbate the OCD. And I underlined the may because sometimes because a stimulant helps you focus more. And unfortunately for some people with OCD, it helps them focus more on their obsessive thought, which is not what we want them to focus on. However, a lot of times a stimulant treatment helps the OCD. And I want to be clear in saying it's not, stimulant treatment is not a treatment for OCD. It's almost helping it indirectly, which means that if for that, for an individual, if part of what gives rise to their OCD or what triggers their OCD is their inattentiveness, is their executive functioning stress brought on by the ADHD. And now you have a medication that is managing and treating those ADHD symptoms. It may never hit that threshold where maybe they would typically hit that would give rise to the OCD. OCD treatment pharmacologically are the SSRIs, which indirectly are helpful for ADHD. Now, there is one SSRI, or it's actually an atypical SSRI called Wellbutrin, which is FDA approved for ADHD. But the ones that are typically prescribed for OCD, medications like Zoloft and Luvox, for example, that they're antidepressants, but they have anti-obsessional qualities to them and targeting obsessional thinking. That is not a treatment for ADHD, but it indirectly helps because, again, if somebody is in a position where their OCD symptoms are managed, they're just more grounded to be able to then work on their ADHD. For a lot of people, they can be on both. Lots of people can be both on a stimulant and an SSRI, and it doesn't have to interact with each other. But as anybody would know, having ADHD may adversely impact the treatment for OCD as well as ADHD. So I always say having untreated, unmanaged ADHD can undermine the treatment of anything, including ADHD. So for experts who are working with OCD patients, it's incredibly important to know about the comorbidity and the diagnosis of ADHD because the ADHD could be the very thing that gets in the way. Now, the gold standard treatment behaviorally for people with OCD is something called exposure plus response prevention, or ERP. And this is going to sound wacky to some people, but this is the gold standard treatment, which is for someone with OCD, because how OCD operates is these intrusive thoughts, which a person is saying, I don't want to think about, they try to avoid them. It often is coupled with these compulsions. The compulsions reduce their anxiety temporarily. But in the long term, with OCD, you give it an inch, it's going to take a mile. It just is like the beast that keeps on taking and taking and taking. And it can get incredibly paralyzing. I mean, I will use this word, and I'm not being hyperbolic, but OCD can be a tormenting disorder. I mean, in terms of what the havoc that it sort of wreaks for people internally and mentally. So the gold standard treatment is exposure, which is you're actually confronting the person with their thoughts, the impulses, the objects, the situations that make them anxious. And then the response prevention is not allowing them to do the compulsive behavior afterwards and basically sit with the anxiety. And now why do we do that? And I can tell you when I was an intern in my training at McLean Hospital, which we have a renowned program on OCD with OCD patients called the OCD Institute. And I remember being told, okay, you know, Roberto, there's this woman, she has something called hit and run OCD is what it's popular called, where she would drive and then anything that felt uneven on the road, she would get this intrusive thought that she hit and killed somebody. And she would know, like, I probably didn't, but what if I did? That would be awful. I would be a horrible person if I left the scene of a crime. She'd have to turn around, get off an exit, go around the highway to that spot. No one was there, no blood on her car. She's like, okay. She'd keep driving and then think, maybe I hit them and they rolled over to the side of the road and I didn't check enough. She would turn around, do that. Then drive off and then think, maybe an ambulance, someone called an ambulance and they're at a local hospital. Oh my gosh, that'd be so bad. Like if I did that, she'd call every local hospital. So needless to say, this woman's life was just paralyzed by this. So I was told, and I was fresh face intern, saying, okay, Roberto, take her in your car and drive through bumpy roads. And if she says, oh my gosh, we have to stop the car, did we hit somebody? I'm supposed to say, maybe we did, maybe we didn't. Which I felt sadistic, you know, saying, I'm like, what? And they said, yes, because if you tell her, no, we didn't hit anyone, I'm reassuring her, which of course is going to bring down her anxiety in the moment. But what is that going to do when she's in the car again, or there's nobody there to reassure her? It's not helping her at all. And for her, it was more the uncertainty actually was the bigger culprit than even the idea of hitting someone. And not that she would want to be hitting anyone, but the uncertainty is what often fuels the OCD. So I said, maybe we did, maybe we didn't. She would get very anxious. But then what happens is the response prevention is we're not going to stop. We're not going to go back to the scene of the crime. And we did this 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. And after, you know, even after the first week, I noticed her symptoms going down. And by the end of 2 to 3 weeks, there was no activation anymore. Because what happens is that the brain thinks, oh, I guess that couldn't have been that dangerous because nothing happened. So if I have a thought that if I say the word cancer, that my mother's going to get cancer. And what I would do as an exposure, as a clinician with someone, is I would have them write the word cancer 100 times. I might have them watch a cancer special on YouTube. I might have them, see pictures of cancer cells. And this sounds, again, like really like me, raises their level of anxiety, and you don't do any mental rituals around. And then lo and behold, the mother doesn't get cancer, and they realize, oh, these two things really don't have to do with each other. So those are just some examples. Now, where ADHD comes in is this kind of work often requires coaching, where you're working with a person. I mean, you can do self-directed exposures where I'll sign a patient and they'll do it on their own. Most of the time at the beginning, they really need somebody there to support them in coaching. I have such an admiration for patients who do this kind of work, because imagine if I told you you had to do the thing that terrifies you the most. So for people with ADHD, they definitely need that motivation and accountability more. And typically what you do is you create a hierarchy of, you know, sort of like the least threatening to the most, you know, threatening. And interestingly, with patients of mine who have ADHD and OCD, that we often have to start on a higher rung due to having like a higher stimulus threshold. Like I remember, for example, working with someone who had both, and they had contamination fears, and they had to put their hands on a dirty toilet seat. And they just had to sit there with their hands on a dirty toilet seat for half an hour. And then the goal was not to wash their hands for 2 hours afterwards. They're putting their hands on the toilet seat. Now, the goal is you want their anxiety to raise so that what goes up must come down. And this person wasn't as anxious as I thought they would be. And this happened to be someone who also had ADHD. And I said, you know, what are you thinking of now? Because you don't want them thinking of anything except the fact that my hands are on a disgusting, dirty toilet seat. And the patient said, oh, I'm just thinking about like Disneyland and going, you know, to their Disney World. And because, you know, he has ADHD, said he's very vivid imagination. I said, oh, okay, well, I'm glad you told me that, because we don't want you thinking of Disney World. I want you to be thinking about all the people that sat on this toilet seat today and feeling that level of anxiety. So it can take sometimes longer to feel anxious due to people with ADHD getting distracted. If there is self-directed exposures, we want it a very specific time, specific day. I don't tell people, okay, this weekend I want you to do this. Just like with any ADHD kind of homework is you want to make it very specific. Okay, 7 p.m. on Thursday, I'll shoot you an email or a call or text or whatever to make sure that you're, you know, doing it. People with ADHD, as we know, all of the issues that can come along with missed sessions or tardiness, being inattentive in sessions, that if you don't identify or understand the ADHD, it's very easy for a clinician working with someone with OCD to think that a person isn't motivated, that they really don't want to do the work, that they're almost sabotaging, they're treatment resistant, which I don't like that term, when in fact, this is somebody that just has a hard time with time management and getting, you know, to sessions. And also there's this, what we call a whack-a-mole phenomenon, meaning that with people who have both, I often see this phenomenon when if their OCD is really high and activated, their ADHD symptoms might be almost mitigated. So for example, one of the things we see is even with people with hyperactive ADHD, who also have OCD, that their hyperactivity tends to be a little mitigated by some of the OCD. So there's almost a protective factor of them not being as impulsive or hyperactive because they have OCD. But so when the OCD symptoms are high, the ADHD impulsive symptoms might be low. But as the OCD symptoms get low, we'll often see the impulsivity sort of come up. So they have that sort of interaction. So I will stop there. We have about 15 minutes for questions and answers.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Roberta. That was excellent. It evoked a lot of questions. So I'm just going to try to run through them as quickly as I can, but take your time answering as needed. If someone has obsessive thoughts, but not yet the compulsive behavior, will the latter compulsive behavior develop later in life?
Not necessarily. So a lot of times, I mean, typically it can, meaning that sometimes people who have the pure O or the obsessionality, interestingly, when I've worked with patients who have the pure obsessionality, will often say, I wish I had compulsions. And of course, you know, they really don't. Mm-hmm. I mean, compulsions are very tormenting, but they say like they just wish they can just be get out of their heads and almost have some physical way of feeling like they're neutralizing those thoughts. So sometimes compulsions can sort of develop because somebody almost sees it as the lesser of two evils. But no, it doesn't always have to. There are many people I've worked with where it's just pure obsessionality that don't have compulsions. So it's really around what happens is they get locked into sort of these thoughts and they're just trying to push them away. Like it's this mm-hmm. constant avoidance that they're trying to do. Now the exposure would be similar where it's like, okay, let's bring in what those terrible thoughts are that you're having. And maybe we have a technique called the worry hour where somebody will have a very designated set of time, usually an hour, where they'll sit down and they don't put on the TV, no phone, they're not distracted, and all they do is obsess. And what you find, and this is especially true for people with ADHD, this is where the ADHD can actually almost work for someone, it's very hard to actually obsess for an hour straight, to just obsess. Now, it's easy to be anxious all day long about something if it's competing right. with other stimuli. But what my ADHD patients humorously say, they're like, yeah, I'm bored after 8 minutes thinking of this. Mm-hmm. Like if I'm just thinking about this obsession, I'm like, I fell asleep in the middle of doing the worry hour. So sometimes it can help.
That's funny. Who can best diagnose ADHD and OCD in adults? Several people have wondered, psychologists, neuropsychologists, psychiatrists. I mean, are there several specialists that a person, an adult with OCD would have to see to get the diagnosis nailed down?
Yeah, I would say so. With OCD, psychologists definitely are trained in clinical work and in diagnosis. With neuropsych testing can pick up on obsessive compulsive features and traits, but it maybe could sort of say these are features of a test that might be sort of features of obsessive compulsive disorder, but I wouldn't say that that's sufficient. I would always tell someone to go see a therapist, a psychologist that can do an evaluation who has expertise in OCD, because OCD can look like anxiety. I mean, it's kind of seen as an anxiety yeah. disorder, but it is very different than generalized anxiety disorder or anxiety or phobias, for example. Sometimes, you know, I've worked with patients who come in with a diagnosis of OCD, and in my assessment and evaluation of them, they have post-traumatic stress disorder, and that a lot of the intrusive thoughts they're having are related to trauma that they've experienced in their life. And it's not a diagnostic or treatment model of OCD. And in fact, some of the exposure would actually only trigger and re-traumatize them. And so we want to be very careful with diagnosing. So definitely psychologists, some psychiatrists who have experience in that. And with ADHD, it would be the same, with the exception with neuropsych testing. Neuropsych testing is not seen as a real effective way of being the one and only way of assessing for ADHD, meaning that there are a lot of actual false negatives with neuropsych testing. So people who have ADHD who don't test as having ADHD. If you test as having ADHD on neuropsych, you probably have ADHD. But there are lots of people who, you know, one-on-one in a very controlled environment, doing a task for 5 minutes or less is not generalizable to sitting in a class or a meeting or my case, an accountant's office, you know, for 40 minutes and hold, you know, their attention. So neuropsych testing can be very helpful in picking up features of things, but I would absolutely recommend seeing a psychologist or psychiatrist that has training in diagnosing those conditions.
Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, several questions about, and I hadn't heard of this, is there an overlap between ADHD and obsessive compulsive personality disorder?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So OCPD, or obsessive compulsive personality disorder, and that's something I, if I had more time, but I'm glad somebody asked the question, is different than OCD. So a lot of times people think OCPD is the same as OCD. Lots of people with OCPD do not have OCD. So what we mean by an obsessive compulsive personality disorder are individuals who are incredibly rigid, very inflexible, often, you know, will have these sort of traits of narcissism and feeling like that they have the right way or committed to the perfect way of doing things, sometimes can devalue other ways of doing things, can be sometimes excessively frugal, like to a very, again, pathological level, like somebody who might be very wealthy, who uses the same napkin for a week because he doesn't want to throw it out in that way. Very high degree of sort of morality, but in a hyper morality sort of sense, where so people with OCPD and often, you know, and even with OCPD, sometimes you'll see overlap with like autism spectrum, or you might see, and you know, what's the chicken, what's the egg? Is someone who's predisposed, if you're, let's say, someone who's on the spectrum, who's very rigid, not very emotionally affective, people with OCPD tend to be very heady, and often their affect is not very expressive. They often devalue emotions and devalue people using emotions as a way of interpreting the world. People with OCPD often have a very difficult time enjoying things just for the sake of enjoying them. So a lot of times I'll see people like with anorexia, for example, with OCPD, because they feel, well, if I don't need to eat that food and I can survive, then why am I eating, you know, that food? Mm-hmm. There aren't any studies that have actually looked at ADHD, OCPD. I've seen patients who have both. I would say it's not common. I think that because an OCPD individual is on the extreme end of not being impulsive. I mean, to the degree like you want them to be, you know, more impulsive. They're not pleasure seekers at all. In fact, to them, it's all intellectual. Like everything is intellectualized. Like why, you know, it's almost like that language of pleasure is a very hard thing. So it's, I would say it's not a very common comorbidity.
Oh, okay. As a woman with ADHD, I'm very aware that my symptoms rise and fall depending on where I am in my menstrual cycle. Do you know if this is common with OCD symptoms as well?
Yeah, so we know that with mood and mood disorders that women, you know, depending on where they are in their menstrual cycle, and for some women, it doesn't impact them at all. And for other women, it's a pretty significant impact. I mean, there is a diagnosis called premenstrual dysphoric disorder, or PMDD, which is not, you know, this fad diagnosis of people like, oh, are we just talking about PMS? No, I mean, I've worked with women who are suicidal the days before they have their period and get into a very, very dark depression and very dark place. It is a real thing. And with OCD, you know, so most of the research I would say is in relation to mood disorders like depression, bipolar spectrum disorders, emotional regulation. But I've also seen that with OCD. Now, whether that's because the mood is a little bit destabilized, and because mood is destabilized, it gives rise to like almost this internal way of gaining control if one feels inherently out of control, either internally from a mood state perspective or an executive function perspective. So I have not come across studies that have particularly linked in a body of research that looks at OCD and menstrual cycle. But I would say indirectly, I've seen that clinically where women are aware that their OCD symptoms can sometimes be worse at certain times of the month or be better. Particularly during like the ovulation window, where again, you typically see with mood that women tend to have elevated mood states during the ovulation window. And evolutionary biology would say that's because, you know, Mother Nature wants them to be in a good mood to have sex to reproduce because they're ovulating. And so similarly, we'll often see the OCD symptoms indirectly get better.
Mm-hmm. You brought up trauma before, and I just wanted, several people have asked, can trauma bring on or exacerbate ADHD or OCD?
Absolutely, for both. And a lot of times when trauma is in the picture, it, you know, it's like a lot of things, and this is particularly true for ADHD. The ADHD, I would say it's the rule rather than the exception that someone with ADHD is going to have a comorbid condition or disorder, whether that's an addiction, whether that's eating disorder, substance abuse, a learning disability. I rarely will see it sort of alone, mood, anxiety disorders. So what we also know is people with ADHD are more likely to have histories of trauma. Now, whether that's because, let's say, someone with ADHD has a parent, because we know it's heritable with ADHD, and if that ADHD is not managed or treated, you might have a parent that's emotionally dysregulated, maybe a parent that's a substance abuser, that is has impulsivity themselves that will rely on, let's say, physical beatings as opposed to, you know, verbal discipline. And as a result, now you have a child that's, you know, getting physically abused. We also see higher rates of sexual abuse in individuals with ADHD. And we have to tease out that, you know, how much of this is, you know, what is the part of it that's the ADHD that was there all along that might have sometimes given rise to the trauma in ways, and then how the trauma also then exacerbates the ADHD symptoms, which it will, in terms of inattention, in terms of ability to ground oneself. We know from trauma literature, it can have neurological impacts on emotional regulation systems, the fight or flight system and the limbic system, which is the part of our brain that assesses threat. And similarly with OCD, that sometimes I'll work with individuals where their OCD is really a function solely of their trauma. They might not have a family history of obsessive compulsive disorder, and that they never had any OCD symptoms until a sexual assault or a military combat for veterans that I've worked with, where then they're getting these intrusive thoughts that are very related to the trauma. And then there are people that have had OCD all along and have had trauma, of which the trauma then kind of sort of intersects with it, and it makes it something bigger. So when trauma's in the picture, it absolutely can exacerbate any condition. Sometimes it could be the condition making things look like ADHD and OCD when they might not be.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One last quick one, please. Sure. Just because this was asked, the effect of OCD on relationships, marriages, divorce, is there any literature on that?
Yeah, so unfortunately, OCD can have major impact in relationships and in terms of divorce as well. And that's why with anyone, you know, whether it's ADHD or OCD, or certainly if people have both, it's really, really important to, when you're in a relationship, either with someone with ADHD and or OCD, either to have, you know, some couples counseling, or to educate yourself if your loved one has ADHD and OCD, to how to help them. One of the things actually that often happens in OCD, in relationships with OCD, is something called an accommodation syndrome, which can start with parents and their children with OCDs, because it's tormenting to see your loved one being so riddled by obsessions or doing compulsions that, you know, if they say, you know, mom, are you going to die tomorrow? You want to be like, no, I'm not going to die tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Reassurance that you want to help your child. The truth is, though, that's not helping them. And it's actually making the OCD worse. And I remember getting a call many years ago from a man whose son had body dysmorphic disorder, actually a type of it called muscle dysmorphia, which I do have done a lot of research about. He was a bodybuilder who thought he looked too small, almost like a reverse of anorexia. And this father said, oh my gosh, like at first he would be like, dad, do I look muscular? Did it look like mm-hmm. I lost muscle? And he'd be like, no, you look fine. It was started as once a week, he said. And then it escalated to 100 times a day, his mm-hmm. son would ask him. And he said, I'm going batty. Like at this point, his father went from being very empathic to almost being driven crazy by it and thinking, come on, like, stop asking me, like, you know, but obviously that's the nature of the disorder. And so it can be really hard if you're in a marriage with someone and kind of fall into that. And so a lot of times with partners in those relationships, I'll get calls from the partners of OCD saying, I don't know what to do. Like, should I be cleaning with extra Lysol, or am I making it worse? Should I be tiptoeing around? Like, you know, I worked, you know, with a patient years ago who, you know, his first marriage ended in divorce. And he's like, I don't blame her. He said, my OCD was so bad that I would require everyone in the family, his wife, his two kids, to strip down in their backyard. They don't have an indoor porch in their backyard before they entered the house, because I was so fearful of any germs mm-hmm. on the clothes. The clothes that yeah. had to be put in a trash bag had to be used with a certain detergent that costs a ridiculous amount of money that he got from Europe. I mean, it was this, and he says, he goes, how could anyone live with that? He goes, I lost my marriage because of this. So there's a lot of work in how to support your partner, but also you have to self-care as well, because OCD is really, really hard. It's not the person. You don't want to think of the person as being the enemy. Right. You want to think of the OCD as being the enemy.
Right. Well, I think the hour's up. Thanks so much for being here and sharing your expertise. It was excellent as usual. And thank you so much again for doing this.
Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure.
And thanks to all of the attendees for joining us. Please join us, I guess it's next week on Feb 16th, when Dr. David Goodman will talk about the most effective treatments for older adults with ADHD. And please make sure you don't miss future Attitude webinars, ADHD expert articles, or important research updates by signing up to receive our free email newsletters at attitudemag.com/newsletters. So thanks everyone for being here, and have a great day.